Am I audible now?
Yeah, good.
Okay. So let me thank one and all, especially this dynamic team headed by Dr. Mohammed Ismail and my very close friend and colleague, Dr. Rajendran, and Dr. Gopal Subramaniam, who is our treasurer. He is like Halley's Comet for me. I meet him only once in 12 years. Anyway, today I had a chance to see Dr. Gopal once again. As Dr. Ismail has said, this module is primarily meant for the practicing pediatrician. So all the modules have been designed with only that goal, to keep the less of theory and to have more practical inputs and have more rational approach to everyday problem that we all face in our day-to-day practice. So it is a brainchild and has been having the blessing and the patronage of lots of souls who I will acknowledge in the last slide. Without further ado, let me get on with the presentation of an approach to fever for more than 7 days. So the scope of today's presentation is overview of the topic. We will briefly discuss the categories of the disease which can present with fever of more than 7 days, how to develop the focused approach to this problem. Even though we are practicing in the peripheries, all of us today will have some access to at least some basic lab services. Let us see how to make optimal use of these lab services. Last, we will talk about the principles of practicing rational medicine in a resource-limited setting and also very clearly define what is the role of empirical therapy and the severest bugbear for all the practicing pediatricians in the periphery. When do we assume that this is beyond our scope of practice, and when do we refer and where to refer and why are we referring? So these will be the presentation points. Coming to the overview of the topic, depending on the setup of one's practice, fever for more than 7 days is a common enough problem that we see. However, we have to make sure that we are talking in genuine terms of fever rather than neti sudade, adivirus sudade, vague terms which parents very often use to impress upon us that the problem is much more severe than we think it is. So sometimes they may exaggerate. So wherever possible, look at a temperature record to confirm that this fever is indeed more than 7 days. Having said that, this problem, clinical problem of fever more than 7 days, could have very, very diverse etiological classes ranging from very innocuous infections to potentially lethal disorders. And often, because the disease is progressing every day and the child is not getting better, it leads to lots of parental anxiety and the cost of care also keeps going. And we are forced to do more and more investigations and sometimes often start empirical therapy without a clear diagnosis. Having discussed the broad outlines, it is easy for everyone to understand that within this group of fever, there may be very uncommon diseases with very variable outcomes. It is of utmost importance to nail the diagnosis as early as possible. Now, depending on each one's private practice experience, I'm sure over a period of years, all of us would have had our own algorithm shaped by our experience of how to approach such patients. Coming to the categories of disease, we are living in a tropical country. We are in the threshold of the hinterland between a developed country and a developing country. And for us, in primary practice, infections will continue to be the dominant cause of fever, which causes fever more than 7 days. However, beyond infections, we also have to think of inflammatory diseases, hematoreticular malignancies, and tumors. We'll have to think of both immune deficiency as well as a hyperactive immune system. And sometimes we will be having the frustration of dealing with a truly idiopathic cause of fever. Coming to the focused approach, all of us in a child who's got a short pyrexia are quite happy to take a very brief history and start prescribing. However, the topic of today's discussion is fever of more than 7 days. So in my humble opinion, time spent in taking a good history is never time wasted. In particular, we need to find out whether it's a continuous fever, which will point towards a typhoid, or whether it is a high-grade intermittent fever, which is a very suggestive fever of a hidden septic focus like a pneumonia or a occult bacteremia or an osteomyelitis or a UTI. The timing of fever. Classically, we've been told that there is an evening rise of temperature in patients suffering from Mycobacterium tuberculosis disease. And we always ask for history of weight loss to corroborate the mother's history that of long fever with the recent weight loss, because appetite is one of the first victims of any prolonged pyrexia. Not important, not to be ignored, is the recent travel history, personal history, and also find out whether the child has been taking any anticholinergics or drugs which might elevate the body temperature. Always include in your history taking some red flags which will point to a sinister pathology like progressive abdominal distension, mood and appetite alterations. Always ask them about focal findings, whether the disease which has started off with a 7-day fever is going to give us some clues from the history as to what the focus might be, like a joint pain, a joint swelling, a backache, a headache, a visual obscuration, a dysuria or painful micturition, significant joint and bone pains beyond the general caecal caudal that most of our patients are happy to divulge and confuse us. Very important is to look for constitutional symptoms and also ask for history of worsening state of consciousness. Let me illustrate all these points with a couple of case scenarios. Coming to case scenario number one, we are looking at a 7-year-old boy with fever of 10 days duration. The fever is high grade, continuous with myalgia and malaise and headache. The physical examination is normal except hepatosplenomegaly, and there is evidence of generalized lymphadenopathy. The counts, the urine analysis, and the peripheral smear were normal, and the child has already received 2 escalated doses of antibiotics without any significant improvement in his symptoms. Not to be outdone, they have actually done a bone marrow study to look for occult causes. Their bone marrow culture was also normal, and the child continues to be unwell. Whereas, when we got back, when we referred of this child, we found that the child comes from a rural atmosphere in Erode district. The family were farm dwellers, and therefore, in this history where all the usual investigations, usual culprits have been ruled out, we thought of unusual pathogens, and we asked very specifically for a history of unboiled cow's milk ingestion, so which was present. Paal vadiyum indha moonjikku paala kudichu andha kuzhandhaikku vandhadhu enna nu ketta brucellosis. So that was the only history that could guide us as to the diagnosis. We proved brucellosis by having a pad titers of rising values to brucella antigen to confirm that it was indeed brucellosis. So more than the investigations, it was a simple history of unpasteurized, unboiled cow's milk ingestion which gave us a diagnosis. The child responded very well to doxycycline and rifampicin. Coming to the next aspect, the focused approach of a child with fever more than 7 days, coming to the physical examination, as pediatricians, our pandits and our gurumas have always been telling us of the importance of looking for weight and height and see whether the child's weight alone is affected, which is typical of an acute disease, or whether the stature has also been affected, which is a sign of an underlying chronic disease of which fever may be a recent manifestation. 2, take time to personally record the blood pressure, the pulse rate, if possible BP in both upper limbs and lower limbs, and you will get lots of clues from merely looking at the pulse oximeter and the vital parameters. Concentrate on pallor, clubbing, generalized lymphadenopathy, rash and edema. I don't need to tell a private practitioner or a practicing pediatrician the importance of subtle and simple clues which you can get from only stripping the child and doing a thorough physical examination. Having done the general examination, based on your history, we proceed to do a systemized examination in a cephalocaudal manner so that no system is missed. To illustrate the importance of a physical examination, let us look at case scenario number 2, which is of a 13-year-old girl who's been having fever of a low-grade nature continuous of 14 days duration, which on closer interrogation, the parents also report she's not been eating well and she's been having joint pains for the past 1 month. They also report that she's been having less urine for the past 2 weeks, and the parents have noticed increasing swelling around the eyelids. This child was treated as a child with acute nephritis with a course of antibiotics and furosemide, but a simple physical examination was the one which gave us the clue. கால் வரைக்கும் பார்த்தாங்க பீடல் அடிமா, ஒரு கால் அடி மேலே பார்த்திருந்தா முக்கால்வாசி ப்ராப்ளம் தீர்ந்திருக்கும். This child has got a very, very telltale rash which is on the dependent areas of the lower limbs. Therefore, based on this physical examination, We wanted to revisit the child's physical parameters, and you can see she is hypertensive, and the investigations are showing pancytopenia with elevated ESR and a low C3, and the urine is showing features of nephritis with relatively low C3. Based on these combinations of a rash, arthralgia, fever, joint pain with pedal edema and periorbital puffiness with pancytopenia inflammatory markers, we were able to restrict our differential diagnosis to vasculitis, adolescent girl child. SLE should be coming first in our differentials. We would also be looking at rickettsial disease, meningococcemia, systemic onset JN, infective endocarditis, and this child had an ANA and anti-dsDNA positive, and the final diagnosis was confirmed to be SLE. A word about ANA, make sure that ANA is not looked at by ELISA alone, because nearly 3 to 5% of the population may be having ANA positive. When you're in doubt, always confirm it with an immunofluorescence and look at the pattern of staining. That may be more confirmatory than merely looking at ANA by ELISA, unnecessarily scaring the parents and ourselves. What is the third aspect of the focused approach that we want to highlight? Whenever we deal with an infectious disease, always keep in mind a mental picture of the natural course of the disease. Let's see what the case scenario number 3 teaches in this regard. This is a 5-year-old girl child who presents to us with fever of 5 days duration. It's a monsoon season. The child is sick looking, has a hepatomegaly and rash, no brainer. We investigated for dengue. She has NS1 negative and IgGM and IgG are positive. Confirmed that this is a secondary dengue infection. She is treated as per dengue protocol, seemed to be getting better, but within 3 to 4 days, she has fever, rash, and malaise has reappeared. When we revise the physical examination, we see a sicker looking child who's febrile. She is hypotensive. Her capillary refill time is just acceptable. She has bilateral pedal edema. She has generalized adenopathy, and the diffuse maculopapular rash, which seemed to be waning, is coming back and it's not blanching. She's got multiple petit K. In addition to the hepatomegaly, she now has splenomegaly. You can see the flushed appearance and the rash and the purpuric nature of the rash with the pedal edema on the lower limbs. Now we are wondering, this is a child with a secondary dengue who seemed to be getting better, but something is going wrong and the child seems to be getting the same disease revisited. What is it that's going on? The natural course of an uncomplicated secondary dengue means with improvement of fever, with improvement of appetite and urine output, and improving PCV and platelet counts and general wellness, we expect that the child to make a complete comeback and recovery, except for some bit of arthralgia. However, this child is sick looking, has got a reappearance of fever and rash, and therefore we need to look at other reasons. Now, many of these children would need intensive care unit. They may be on multiple IV lines, and therefore thrombophlebitis or a hospital-acquired infection or a catheter-associated sepsis could be the reasons why the child with dengue who seemed to be getting better is coming back to be sick. However, are there complications of dengue that we should be keeping in mind? We proceed to investigate. Before we investigate more and more, it'll be useful to just revise our own counts and have a temporal profile and see what did this child's count show. You can see from day 5 to day 7, all the parameters seem to be suggesting an improvement, whereas between day 7 and 9, we seem to be having a visitation of the same old problem wherein pancytopenia is creeping in again and the child is unwell. Peripheral smear confirms pancytopenia, but there are no hemoparasites or blasts or abnormal cells. On further investigation, SGOT and SGPT are elevated, there is a ferritin elevation, fibrinogen is decreased, hypertriglyceridemia is present. Yes, you guessed it right. This was a child who had an atypical dengue course, and we suspected a complication of dengue and investigated for them. Secondary HLH. But if you know the natural course of dengue, then you know that this child is not following the natural course, and therefore you are on your guard, and we are intervening in time to get the correct diagnosis going. Right. So let us proceed to case number 4, which again reinforces the fact that there is no substitute for correlating history, lab investigations with repeated examination of the patient. It is not enough to see the child once, exam and re-exam. This is an 11-year-old boy with fever of 7 days and headache of 4 days duration. He's been having a poor appetite, appears very withdrawn and poorly communicative. There is no vomiting, no rash, no joint pain, dysuria, cough, or earache. His basic blood investigations are non-contributory, workup for enteric fever, malaria, dengue, are all normal. You can see that he's a well-thriving child. He's having 103, doesn't want to communicate, and absolutely nothing on clue. If you go through the admission notes of the doctor, it says systemic examination is normal, except the fact that he's circumcised. No meningeal signs are noticed. A glance at the counts also shows that his counts, his ESR, his urine, and his basic investigations are literally leaving us clueless. However, this is a child who's been unwell for a long while, he's having headache, he's having high-grade fever, so we wanted to reinvestigate by thorough physical examination, and this is what we saw. We saw this classical eschar at the root of the penis. The mighty mite might bite you anywhere. So that is a useful point to remember. Wherever we think it is embarrassing, where we don't look, that is exactly where you will get to see the eschar. And many a PG, even we as PGs, have been put to shame by our professors showing and picking up an eschar, which we missed on our busy OPD or in the admission desk. So this is a child who had a scrub typhus proven by CART test, and he responded magically to doxycycline. It underlines the importance of thorough. However, sometimes it may be embarrassing, but if you justify why you are doing this, most parents will be quite happy to oblige us, because it's after all their child's life which is on the line. Annachi, Akka, enge poidaringa, please maintain the same girth. 10 more slides and we are done. Making optimal use of the lab. Like I told you, even though it may be pediatricians practicing in the periphery, all of us have access to some essential laboratory services. And before we embark on more invasive and expensive investigations, it will be very useful to look at certain basic blood parameters. What is written here, most of them would be available to most of us. How we use these laboratory investigations to our advantage is a different topic altogether. We'll have a couple of modules on how to interpret Coulter's, how to interpret counts, how to interpret chest X-rays in subsequent modules. But here, I want to highlight, let us go stepwise and start with the essential basic investigations before we proceed to more advanced investigations. Once the basic investigations have not given us a clue, you can have a focused imaging like an X-ray of an affected region of interest. It could be antigen detection test. It could be MANTU, ultrasound to look for occult intra-abdominal foci. If you're strongly suspecting an inflammatory disorder like SLE, an anti-nuclear body. If you have a swelling which is amenable to FNAC or biopsy, we may go for an invasive investigation and appropriate use of serological investigation. Let us see yet another common scenario where labs can sometimes mislead us if you're not wary. This is a 4-year-old girl child from Erode who has fever of 17 days duration with weight loss and progressive pallor and multiple bone pains. She has generalized adenopathy, pallor, and she has a few petty K. The hemoglobin is low. She has a low normal total counts and a lymphocytosis. Platelets are low and the ESR is high. Peripheral smears were normal. There were no hemoparasites or blast cells. ASO is not suggestive of an acute rheumatic fever and the ANA is negative. However, this child's MANTU was reported 12/12 and the MRI, which was done as part and parcel of investigation of the child's fever, weight loss, and multiple bone pains, was reported as chronic recurrent multifocal osteomyelitis. Now, based on this investigation, this child was started on 4-drug ATT and followed up. Fever and bone pain reduced after starting the NSAIDs and ATT, but the weight and appetite, which in a classical tuberculosis should show signs of improvement, were absolutely going downward trend, sending alarm signals in the treating physician as well as the parents, because they thought they were having a diagnosis in their hand. And so this child was reevaluated. You can see her counts have dropped by another 3,000. Platelets have dropped. ESR continues to remain sky high. ANA by ELISA is also negative. The peripheral smear still shows no atypical cells. We have fever, we have poor response to ATP, we have a MONTU, we have an MRI report which says this is multifocal osteomyelitis, and the counts are not suggestive of a septic focus, and the peripheral smear continues to remain normal. So what is it that we are missing? So because of the high suspicion of hematoreticular malignancy in such a scenario, we went ahead with the bone marrow aspiration, which confirmed that it was acute lymphoblastic leukemia. We could ask, but the MONTU test was positive. It was 12 into 12. Then we went back to the lab and found out that the MONTU was given, strength was given was 10 TU. Remember, MONTU is a very good test for finding out tuberculosis infection. At higher MONTU rates, probably 3/4 of the audience today would be having a value of 12 into 12. So before you attach any importance to lab, MRI reports, whatever, see whether that report correlates with what you are seeing in the patient. This child did very well with appropriate chemotherapy. What was the morals of this story? The history was suggesting a subacute process rather than acute infective process. There were enough red flags to say the non-response to ATT was also a very important red flag. And regardless of what the lab tests were giving, there was something else sinister brewing, and the MONTU and MRI were wrongly interpreted and not seen in light of the clinical examination findings and the story of the child. These are a couple of rapid diagnostic tests which you are likely to use in your prolonged fever case scenarios. CAR test for malaria, automated urine analysis, typhidot for enteric fever, throat swab for H1N1 COVID-19, where sometimes we are lured by the promise of an early result with an antigen test for COVID-19, which sometimes an RT-PCR may take time, it may be more expensive, but it's worth the wait because a lot is riding on the diagnosis that you give to these patients and their families. A throat antigen test can really miss 1/3 of the COVID-19 cases. Just to illustrate the point that rapid diagnostic tests should be interpreted with caution. We also have NS1, leptospirosis, and dengue CAR test. We have to remember how to interpret these rapid diagnostic tests because sometimes they may mislead a primary care pediatrician into going into the wrong pathway. Let's see it with a case scenario. Case scenario 6 is of a 2-year-old male child who's coming with fever of 7 days duration, excessive crying, refusal of feed for 4 days, vomiting of a day, and a single brief generalized tonic-clonic seizure in the OPD while he's waiting to see his doctor, and the physical examination shows a fretful, irritable child. You can see that he's got red lips, fissured angle, and you can also see the fissuring on the lips. You can see the periorbital puffiness. However, he had no strawberry tongue. He had no lymphadenopathy. He had no edema. This was one fretful, irritable child who is having a seizure on day 7 of illness, and he's sitting there after having had a brief seizure. When you do a side lab investigation, it shows the urine pus cells of 20 with a leukocyte-specific esterase positivity with a nitrate negative. Now, this is the point I want to stress. It's very, very useful to look at the urine analysis with an automated analyzer. However, you look at this more closely, you have pyuria, and because of the pus cells, the leukocyte-specific esterase is positive. However, if you had a nitrate positivity, it's a very, very clear pointer towards the presence of a nitrate-reducing organism, whereas only an LSE positivity with pus cells with a nitrate negative probably points towards a sterile pyuria rather than a urine infection. Regardless, when we did the urine culture, we were not surprised to see that it was sterile. So, is this a UTI? Probably not. Another word of caution, it is very tempting for a primary care pediatrician to attach a uro bag to a clean external genitalia and send that urine for culture. However, please remember that nearly 50 to 75% of all positive cultures that you will get from a bag sample are likely to reflect perineal colonization rather than true UTIs, and we'll be falsely treating them on the surmise that the child has a UTI. So what did this child's investigation show? You can see there is striking leukocytosis with a polymorph predominance suggesting there is acute infection or inflammation. We have an ESR of 84 and a vastly elevated 120 CRP, and the TV echo gave us a diagnosis of showing a dilated and ectatic coronaries. So this child had an incomplete Kawasaki disease where the clue was a sterile pyuria, a fretful child, prolonged pyrexia, periorbital puffiness, fissured lips, extreme irritability, headache and seizures. He did not fulfill all the classic criteria, but the lab came to our rescue and the urine culture sterile was another point in favor of this not being a urinary infection. So this is how we need to exercise the caution before we establish a diagnosis only on the basis of testing. Right. Coming towards the last few slides, what is the role of empirical therapy? I can hear many in the audience saying, "Unakkennappa, neenga solvinga, hospital la irkinga, periya periya nursing home la irkinga, enga paada nenachu paarenga." Correct. It is absolutely understandable that in some situations, we cannot strictly practice evidence-based medicine. That should not stop us from trying to get a diagnosis. However, in these situations, it is correct for us to give empirical therapy. Where it is too risky to wait for an etiology like a febrile neonate or a sick neonate, a child with an LRTA or an acute dysentery who comes with septic shock, an acute febrile encephalopathy in our country, which can have a very, very varied differential diagnosis, a child who's on chemotherapy with a febrile neutropenic sepsis, nobody will fault you for giving empirical antibiotics. A child with a nephrotic syndrome who comes with an acute abdomen is spontaneous bacterial peritonitis unless otherwise proved. Therefore, your teacher, your professor, your colleagues will definitely agree with you if you said you started him on a broad spectrum antibiotic. Also, many of us will not have access to PCR and throat swabs and very high fund testing. Very many times, you have to look at the typical clinical picture to consider and see when there is no alternate etiology which can fit in this clinical syndrome, it is probably acceptable to give empirical therapy. Nearly 90% of the enteric fevers that we treat will fall in these criteria. Where there is a high probability of malaria, when a child comes with repeated episodes of protracted cough with a post-sessive vomiting with a classical whoop, when you have a spotted fever presentation of rickettsial disease rather than the scrub typhus, immunofluorescence assay is not available to everyone. Therefore, based on the geography, history, and physical findings, we may be justified in giving a course of doxycycline. A child with sickle cell anemia comes with an acute chest syndrome, is acutely hypoxemic. Probably we will be right if you gave a trial of azithromycin or erythromycin to cover mycoplasma. In our country, chronic meningoencephalitis is most often likely to be tuberculosis, regardless of what the TB PCR and what the labs and the CT and the MRI say. We also have this newly emerging clinical syndrome of persistent bacterial pharyngitis, where all of us may not have access to bronchoscopy or endoscopic evidence of colonization by a bacterial pathogen. Therefore, we may be justified in giving a 14 days course of comoxiclav if the setting and the findings are appropriate. Let us illustrate the need for empirical therapy with a case scenario. This is a 5-year-old boy child brought with 8 days history of high-grade intermittent fever. The fever has been there for close to 7 days, but something has been going wrong in the past 24 hours in the form of worsening sensorium, and the child has started having seizures progressing to status epilepticus. The physical examination showed a febrile child with features of meningeal irritation, and all that we could get was the tip of a spleen, and the only history of a geography, if you want to call it, was a trip to Odisha a month ago. In this child, he has a prolonged pyrexia with an acute encephalopathy syndrome presentation. In this situation, in our country, even the IAP's Critical Care Society approaches justify the use of broad spectrum medications. It could be enteric encephalopathy, so ceftriaxone is justified. It could be mycoplasma manifesting. It could be scrub with or rickettsial disease manifesting with encephalopathy. It could be cerebral malaria or herpes simplex encephalitis. Therefore, in such a child, when you are having a dire situation, a broad spectrum antibiotic, after tracking appropriate samples and investigations, it will be appropriate to give ceftriaxone acyclovir, and that is exactly what we started. The only clue we had was features of meningeal irritation, a trip to Orissa, and a small spleen that we palpated. And we started IV artesunate along with good quality supportive care, and a smear confirmed the presence of a Plasmodium falciparum. After my postgraduate days, this is probably the only case of cerebral malaria I've seen in my professional career for the past 20 years and shows how important, again, history taking and physical examination and empirical therapy can sometimes be of great benefit to the child. Now, practicing rational medicine in a resource-limited setting, sorry about the spelling, all of us cannot do everything, but all of us can definitely do something. Please try to approach fever at discrete categories. We have a short pyrexia syndrome where the fever is typically less than 7 days. You could have an obvious focus like a tonsillitis where no investigations are needed. A physical examination followed by appropriate medication is enough. When you have a short pyrexia without focus, you look at the child. If it's a well child, 90% of the time it's going to be viral illness, which is going to resolve with a lot of patience and hydration. If it's an ill child, it needs evaluation. Now, topic of today's discussion is a second category, pyrexia of more than 7 days with focus, which is obvious on an investigation, treated. It could be UTI, typhoid, whatnot. We are talking about prolonged pyrexia without focus. If the child is well looking, you could probably sit on the child, order some investigations on an OP basis, and keep talking to the parents and reassure them that even though the cause is not found, the child is well enough for us to proceed with a focus, detailed step-by-step evaluation. However, if you have a prolonged pyrexia in an ill child without focus, it is probably safer to admit the child and ask for a battery of tests, which can give us a clue. Coming to the last few slides, when do we refer the child? When we genuinely need a second opinion. All of us are not experts. We may sometimes get into a mind block or a thought blank like Steve Smith got. You could definitely ask for a second opinion from a colleague whose opinion you value and matters to you as an academically shrewd person. When the patient needs more evaluation than is what is available at your setup, when there is a mismatch between the input and the patient's outcome, like the case we discussed about dengue hemorrhagic fever getting complicated by HLH, when more advanced therapeutic intervention is needed. Let us assume that you have admitted a child with lobar pneumonia in your clinic you're treating. However, the child develops a complication in the form of an empyema. This is obviously beyond the scope of a primary care pediatrician. So you are well within your right to ask for an ultrasound, confirm there is a presence of an empyema, and refer to a pediatric surgeon or a setup where a pediatric surgical care and support can be given to this child. If you have a child with a post-COVID multi-inflammatory syndrome or a sick child with dengue or a child who is otherwise immunocompromised, who is likely to have frequent monitoring and intensive care, it could be something like sepsis in a diabetic child or an immunocompromised child, where you want more monitoring and more intensive care is anticipated as per the natural course, your reading of the situation, please refer early rather than late. There might be some NPs, Nachu patients or Nakiran patients, who it is a very, very difficult task to get a good name from. Whatever we do, however much we counsel, they are not happy and they continue to be quarrelsome and they make life miserable and they will have a very demoralizing effect on the patients, attenders, and also on other patients who are getting cared by you when they badmouth you. So such patients are preferably discharged to a care center of their choice rather than trying to hold on them and trying to justify your line of treatment and investigation. Where there's a potential for medical legal issues and you are not powered or you are not empowered or you're not adequately protected, please refer. And last but not the least, when the patient himself says, Varenga poi paakalaangla, city la poi paakalaangla, where da test pannanungla, in the doctor poi paakalaangla, please don't sit on them. Please, with an open mind, be happy to send them. If at the end of the talk, you found that this approach was nice, please share your comments. This is a maiden venture of ours, spearheaded by Dr. Ismail's idea of trying to reach out to the primary care pediatricians with practitioner-friendly modules of common day problems, which may not be always addressed by our routine CMEs. We would be lovely to hear your feedbacks, your positive and negative comments, and the help of these people in the preparation of the module is gratefully acknowledged. Dr. Janani, Dr. Painyanna, Suganthi Ma'am, Dr. Ismail, Dr. Srinivas Raghavan, Dr. Anisha, who had given a valuable input, and Dr. Advaita, doctor in making, who all helped me prepare this module. I hope it served the purpose, and I'm happy to take any questions if there are any. Thank you. Thank you for your patient hearing, and thanks once again for the opportunity to share some thoughts with you on a relaxing Sunday evening.
Thank you, Dr. Aswatthana, and I think you have elaborately presented for PU evaluation. I think you have covered thoroughly enteric fever, brucellosis, and dengue with complications, and scrub typers, and essential basic screening test, and as well as scenario-based investigation also, and PO like mimic like tuberculosis and turn into ALL, and incomplete Kawasaki, and role of empirical antibiotic, and rationale in the resource limited setting starting antibiotic, and malaria endemicity, and you have to always think of, and when to refer the child, and algorithm for the PU approach. It's a good, I think almost you have covered everything. And you have, I think, a couple of questions from the audience side. And why rifampicin is rifampicin in Brucella other than doxycycline, from Dr. Vinod.
Yeah, so Brucella is a very, very fastidious pathogen. So depending on the age of the child, if the child is less than 8 years of age, it is strongly recommended that we give cotrimoxazole with rifampicin. And if the child is having sickness or encephalopathic manifestation, the recommendations are to give aminoglycosides even up to the point of streptomycin. Monotherapy with doxycycline is recommended for diseases like cholera, for rickettsial disease, but for brucellosis, the recommendation is to give two drug therapy. Less than 7 years, we give cotrimoxazole with rifampicin for 6 to 8 weeks. And if the child is more than 7 years, we could give doxycycline with rifampicin. Monotherapy is probably not a good option for brucellosis.
And the next question, when do you do typhi dot? What pick up illness? What is the specificity and sensitivity?
So typhi dot is
by Dr.
Typhi dot is an ELISA based platform where you can do typhi dot IgM or typhi dot IgG. This is a rapid diagnostic test. If you're going to look at a child with an illness of less than 5 days duration, you cannot wait for 48 hours for blood culture. Even Bactalert can take 24 to 48 hours. Or if you have little faith in the Vidal that is provided by your lab, which is the recommendation. We are not recommending Vidal. All of us use it. We do recognize the usefulness of Vidal for all of us, but it is not the recommended test. There are studies in India which says typhi dot is as good, if not superior, to blood culture in the early diagnosis of typhoid fever. So specifically, you can look for IgM.
And when do you do procalcitonin, what is the advantage over CRP? Dr. Manohar.
No, just to complete the answer. So if you're looking at a disease less than...
when do you do procalcitonin, PCT, procalcitonin?
No, I just wanted to finish the answer for the typhi dot.
When do you do...
If you're looking at IgM, less than 7 days. If you're looking at typhi dot IgG, illness of 6 to 7 days duration. Sensitivity and specificity. Specificity approaches nearly 95%. Sensitivity is vastly superior to blood culture, which in most centers is hovering between the 30 to 50% mark, depending on how much of blood volume is taken. When do we do use procalcitonin was the next question. Procalcitonin is, you can say, it's a Richmond CRP. CRP itself is a Richmond ESR. However, sometimes CRP and ESR will not go together. A classical example is of SLE, where the ESR will be sky high and the CRP will be low. And sometimes in what we call the MISSI, the CRP will be sky high and it will be much higher than the ESR value. Having said that, in a child with a nephrotic syndrome or immunocompromised child who's got a septic locus, another example would be a febrile neutropenic child, a procalcitonin sensitivity and specificity to pick up bacterial infection is much better than that of a CRP. CRP is an interleukin 6 driven molecule which can go up even in inflammation, whereas procal is purely driven by bacterial infection. And therefore, if you have a procal positivity and CRP positivity, we can monitor with subsequent CRP. But procal positive, CRP negative is to be taken as bacterial infection. So procal has definitely more sensitivity and positive predictive for a bacterial focus.
So a question from Dr. Premalada, is azithromycin is as effective as doxy?
In what condition, sir?
Is azithromycin as effective as doxy?
Typhus mostly. Typhus
probably
mostly.
Scrub typhus, sir. Probably scrub typhus.
No, again, the drug of choice is doxycycline. If we look at the Goodman and Rathi criteria, they say it's almost like a major criteria. If the child becomes clinically well within 48 hours of doxycycline therapy, it is a point in favor of a rickettsial disease. Azithromycin, rifampicin are all standby drugs. They are not the drugs of choice. So doxycycline continues to be the drug of choice. If there is a contraindication like age or the patient doesn't tolerate a tablet form and the syrup form cannot be prepared, then probably azithromycin can take a look. But the drug of choice continues to remain doxy.
So another thing is azithromycin actually is better in the CNS cases, no? Suppose meningitis. CNS penetration is better in the azithromycin.
Rajan, there no more questions.
Kindly mention about key history and... Yeah, please.
Leptospirosis, like dengue, it's also a disorder which you will suspect when there have been recent rains. A fever, a myalgia. One of the most important or very important clinical clues that we can get for leptospirosis is a headache, where the patient very typically says, kannukku pinnadi valikudhu. Salavalinu solla matanga. They will say, kannukku pinnadi valikudhu, edho kutra mari irukku. That is a finding which is very, very strongly suggestive of leptospirosis. The presence of a hepatomegaly, and coming to the lab parameters, for some unknown reason, a very high LDH is very often seen in leptospirosis. Elevation of creatinine, elevation of LDH, presence of elevated liver enzymes with a headache in a child with fever, with fairly typical counts, no clue from the counts, in a monsoon season, think of leptospirosis.
Treatment for infection-associated HLH.
So treatment for infection-associated LHH will be in the form of treatment of the underlying cause. Virtually any infection could be complicated by HLH. So if it's a treatable infection like bacterial sepsis, we treat it. Very often, if it follows dengue or if it follows infectious mononucleosis or sometimes even after drugs, then we give supportive care in the form of intravenous immunoglobulin, steroids, and if the child doesn't respond, then we step up to cyclosporine, calcineurin inhibitors, and etoposide, along with weekly prophylaxis for fungal infections and pneumocystis prophylaxis.
Any CAR test for strep typhus?
Yes, we do have a CAR test for strep typhus. The question is from Dr. Arivanan. Yes, we do have a CAR test. One brief word about strep typhus CAR test is, it is very often picks up IgG and IgM and even IgA antibodies. So a strep typhus CAR test cannot always distinguish between acute active infection and a person who has had strep typhus in the past, who has still got IgG present in the blood, but whose current illness may not be actually strep. So again, when you have an ISCAR, when you have a leukocytopenia, when you have a polymorphonuclear predominance with leukocytopenia, falling platelet counts, dengue-like illness, think of strep typhus. A CAR test is useful if it correlates with your physical findings. Because all said and done, only 30 to 50% of children with strep will have a classical ISCAR, however hard you look.
Next question from Dr. Vinod. Why ESR is high and CRP low or normal in SLE? Is there any specific reason?
This answer was given to us by Dr. Satish, who is a very good rheumatologist and good friend of ours from CMC Vellore. We had asked him the same question in another forum. He said CRP is driven by interleukin 6, whereas SLE is driven by interferons. So ESR is elevated whenever you have an interferon-dominated pathology. So in SLE, CRP is low because interleukins are not very important in the pathogenesis of SLE, whereas interferons are the ones which are driving the inflammation. That explains why you have a discrepancy between the ESR and CRP in SLE.
So next question from Sadish Kumar. If ferritin is high, that means more than 10,000, steroid has to be given in dengue with HLH?
Absolutely. Because we are talking about a child who's gone beyond the state of viremia. So when your immune system has gone into the overdrive mode, when you have hemophagocytes engulfing everything in the marrow and the child is sinking, steroids and gamma with good quality supportive nursing care will be absolutely justified. This is not a viral illness anymore. It is a post-viral immune activation syndrome, something like a macrophage activation syndrome. Therefore, in the case scenario that Dr. Satish has said, steroids would definitely be justified. Yeah.
It is meant for practicing primary care pediatrician, I think many of the babies coming from outside 7 days, 100% they will be with the antibiotic. So in the history, you must know what antibiotic they have already prescribed. And also, you have to mention about the biphasic fever. Some of the important diseases like COVID, dengue and all, the biphasic fever. This biphasic fever, if you count in 7 days or four, it will come in more than 7 days, you have to consider also. Only my two suggestions as far as antibiotic is concerned, we have to wait. In the recent conference, in the AAP recommendation, prescribing antibiotic for less than 2 years, they strongly object it. Number two, Amdekar was telling you need not give typhoid vaccine. The personal hygiene, water hygiene, everything will definitely prevent. He was announced in the forum that there is no need for typhoid vaccine. These two messages, I got it. So prescribing antibiotics more important, and biphasic fever is also you have to elicit in the history. Many times we will miss. So thank you, Ismail, for the wonderful arrangement.
Thank you, Dr. Jalil. Ashwath, you want to make any comment on that?
I want to make a comment, Dr. Jalil. Actually, until that IAP immunization committee finalizes, I think we can't term it's a typhoid vaccine should not give. I think it is one person. If you are commenting, I think we can't take
it. Dr. Rajendran, he is not against typhoid vaccine. It is.
Yeah, let us leave it at that juncture, please. Let us not debate that point.
He just recommend if you have a personal water and hygiene, everything, typhoid may not be recommended in a correct way. He's telling. Ambedkar is giving the message. He wants to stress the prevention. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Dr. Ashwath, you want to make any comment on that, Ashwath?
No, I would not agree with the deepest possible respect for Dr. Amdekar. I think we cannot make blanket statements because the safe and easy portable drinking water is a distant dream for many of our rural people. So the amount you will spend in taking the typhoid, the testing, the inpatient care, if the delay in diagnosis will definitely not make non-vaccination. If that is argued, then we can stop giving BCG also. That is my personal opinion.
Okay. It's not against typhoid.
Thank you.
It's a message.
Thank you, Dr. Ashwath, for giving a wonderful lecture. I think the algorithm will definitely reach the primary care pediatricians. I would now request the resource persons, Palani Raman sir, Lakshmi madam, and Balashankar to have a word about this.
Yes,
Dr. Palani Raman, please. Dr. Lakshmi, please.
Yes. Good evening, sir. I am Dr. Lakshmi Velmurugaram from IECH, sir. Excellent talk by Professor Ashwath. Very good compilation of cases and clarity. And Okay, sir. Sir, but it was a very good compilation. I really thoroughly enjoyed and the cases were very good. 2-3 things I want to just clarify, sir. during our presentation, probably investigation of choice in each infection. Probably we will stress so that it will be more useful to the primary care physicians, I thought. And one thing, sir, in scrub typhus, we are seeing a lot of scrub in Chennai. For example, in the month of November itself, we had probably seen 70 cases in 1 month. So the daily the number load is heavy. And we don't, I mean, card test for scrub is not probably, IgM ELISA is more useful. Though it is not the confirmatory test, and IFT is the confirmatory test. IFT is not available. Immunofluorescence is not available. But IgM ELISA has a good value, and we do it. And card test, because once you tell it to the primary care physicians, probably the quality of the card, and we don't have a quality check for rapid card test. So IgM ELISA is probably a little better than in. And as you rightly pointed out, you said giving doxycycline is diagnostic and therapeutic. Once you know it, if you feel it is a scrub with no ester, you give doxy, and within 48 hours, the fever comes down. Automatically, it becomes diagnostic and therapeutic test. And somebody had asked whether doxy or azithro, doxy only. IV azithro, because IV doxy is also available. Supposing in a case of AES where you are not able to give oral doxy, patient is vomiting continuously, but vomiting is also not very common in children due to doxy. Children tolerate doxy very well. But still, even in that case, even if there is vomiting, doxy is better. And you can go for IV doxy. But when you go for IV doxy, be careful. Let it be an infusion. And again, then one thing rightly you have pointed out, leukemia with low counts. That was really excellent, because 30% of our leukemias in ICU, 30% is one third of our cases, are presenting not with leukocytosis, but with pancytopenia and leukopenia. Not even with organomegaly. Leukopenia is not aplastic anemia as we previously thought of. It may be a presenting manifestation of leukemia. That also accept. One more thing I had, you were mentioning about card tests in dengue. Being in government sector, we can never go for card testing. We make use of card tests for malaria, because peripheral smear is very difficult to make out. It's the gold standard, but it's very difficult. So we can, but card tests for malaria, we can get. And the point from which I learned from you about Kawasaki is about sterile pyuria. One more thing I can add on to it, the scrag clips with vertical serrations. That is a very characteristic feature of Kawasaki, and BCG activation. That also we see commonly in Kawasaki. These two are other atypical features. Rest of it were all very classic. I think we should emulate up to you, and we'll do. Hope we do a good job like you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Lakshmi. I think now the onus is on your shoulders to take up the North Zone. Please reach all the practicing pediatricians thank you for that. Ashwat, I think you can make the comments after all the zone persons complete their talk. Now to Parani Raman, please.
Bas, Balashankar bas.
Balashankar, yeah, Balashankar. Professor Balashankar.
Sir, Dr. Balashankar, sir.
He's not there.
Balashankar, sir. He was there, I think. Sir, Dr. Pandiraman,
okay, sir. Pandiraman, you can start. La? Pandiraman, let us save some time. Please.
Sir, unmute, sir.
Okay. Number one, why actually now we have chosen fever more than 7 days? This may be thought of many of the practicing pediatrician, and we are all not comfortable with fever of more than 7 days. We try to mostly refer to the higher institution. This is the thing maybe in the minds of the people. The thing is, majority of time, all the discussions, we had enough discussion on short duration fevers. So majority of times, this short duration fever is not properly managed, and partially treated infections go for the prolonged fever. So see to that you properly manage the short duration fever so that it is not becoming a prolonged fever, number one. And number two, with respect to the typhoid test, particularly the typhoid, this is, I'll beg to differ with Ashwath. And the typhoid test is as good or as bad as Vidal. And all the top class ID experts say that if possible, blood culture or otherwise go for the clinical and with corroborative lab tests like leukopenia, eosinopenia. This is more than enough for particularly for typhoid, number two. Number three, and at any point of time for a practicing pediatrician, if the child is sick, better try to not to handle or meddle with it, whether it's a short duration fever or a prolonged duration of fever, better try to refer to the institution. Now, in the presence of the medico-legal thing, it is not a good thing to meddle with a sick child, whether a short duration or a prolonged duration, number two. Number four, and particularly when you are, particularly when it's a prolonged fever, about 50% of the times, they are the infections. Try to think about uncommon infections, first typhus, then the typhoid, or some other uncommon infection from head to foot, like sinusitis or simple otitis media sitting there, or the partial pneumonia, but not partially treated, you will be taking the simple x-ray to can come it out. So all these things, try to find it out, maybe a simple infection, 50% of the times they are again infections. Only the remaining 25% are on the rheumatological causes and thing. Among the rheumatological causes, you know only that there are only the three things, whether arthritis group or connective tissue group or vasculitis group. Arthritis group, we all know the only condition we have is, yes, that is systemic onset juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, but it is a diagnosis of exclusion. Up to 2 weeks, don't ever diagnose, yes, particularly systemic onset rheumatoid arthritis, up to two weeks, don't ever, it is a diagnosis of exclusion. I guess we majority of time try to over-diagnose, that is systemic type of onset of rheumatoid arthritis. Coming to the connective tissue disorder, the main thing is the SLE, and we mainly leave it to older, particularly older female children. And we, if at all you suspect, refer to a particular proper person like Ashwath or Satish Kumar or anybody, number two. Number three, are anything scenario like, particularly when there are severe constitutional symptoms or red flags with the pallor and particularly petechiae, purpurae, hepatosplenomegaly, it is a high time you see to that, you don't meddle with that case. Majority of times it can be a malignancy, better refer. So this is the thing. So only thing in a well child with a prolonged fever, after ruling out uncommon causes, you can wait for 2 to 3 days after trying to see that subtle signs and symptoms from head to foot, subtle signs, symptoms may be there, or subtle signs may be there, or some nuanced investigative clues may be there. So you try to pick it up. If possible, try to do for meddle for 48 to 72 hours. Otherwise, don't, heaven's sake, don't meddle with the prolonged fever. This is my humble request. As a practicing pediatrician, I'm trying to tell, because the other people are from the institutions, their approach may be different. On behalf of a practicing pediatrician, this is my approach. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Palaniraman. And the idea behind this program is this. I just want people to have a clear-cut idea so that it can be taken up by the primary care pediatrician, so that they can be become much confident what to refer, when to refer, how to go about it. Yes. And next, I go out to Dr. Professor Balashankar for his comments. Professor Balashankar?
Sir, Dr.
Sir, hello.
Yeah, please tell me, sir.
Hello.
Vanga ba, solunga
ba. Audible.
Yes, bas.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Audible.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes. Solunga ba, sir.
Yeah.
Oh, please. Thing is, sir. Let it be, but let us treat or not treat, that is different. But there is a joy in referring with the possible diagnosis. It is always a joy to have a possible diagnosis and write a reference. So in that way, eliciting a clear, thorough history and a thorough physical examination starting from head to foot, not leaving an inch of the body, thorough clinical examination and a detailed history will help us to pinpoint at least one or two or three at the maximum diagnosis, from where we can refer it to a higher center where facilities are available. That's what I honestly feel. So primary care physicians, they should know all these things. There is nothing wrong in knowing so many things. So they let them know all these things and let them know the problems and complications of so many things. And it is better to diagnose and write with some possible diagnosis to the referring physician. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Balashankar. I now request all the three zonal key persons to take care of this fever module, to reach the primary care physicians in the respective zones. Either you can do a physical meeting or you can do a Zoom meeting and make sure that every branch is in your zone conducts this fever module within the month of February. Thank you. Now I call upon Ashwath to make any conclusive remarks. Ashwath?
Dr. Viswanathan, I think any doubt, Viswanathan,
Just one question, sir. Yeah. Dr. Janani has mentioned modified FAIN criteria for leptospirosis. The speaker, Dr. Ashwath, or one of the key resource person, can just explain that if it's a clinical...
Yeah, that is what. Conclusive remarks is coming. It's coming for the conclusive remarks.
Thanks for all your feedback. Because this is a module which is prepared for a person, I've taken only representative investigation. There will always be a drug of choice. There will always be an investigation of choice. But the drug of choice and investigation of choice is not something which will be available to the peripheral pediatrician. So a CAR test, a rapid diagnostic test is what he will have access to. So the point behind putting the CAR test is not to show that that is to be done. It is just to show when to order it. Also be aware of the false positives as well as the false negatives. Be prepared to see the pitfalls in the diagnosis or the sensitivity and specificity of each of these investigations. We will take it on board. We will modify the module to include all the suggestions given by the zonal coordinators. Like, we are all mature adults, so we have every reason to believe, agree or disagree on certain tests. Like I told, Vidal is not recommended by any professional body, but all of us in our private practice, whether we are sitting in ICH or in a rural area, we have to take recourse to Vidal. So the rising titer, which the textbooks talk, is very, very difficult. Who will come back to you for 2 weeks later to show a fourfold rise in titer? So definitely in the appropriate setting, in our setup, a positive Vidal can be taken as a pointer towards a enteric fever or a typhoid fever. That is the point I wanted to make. And we have papers from Mysore, which cement or which I've quoted in the answer to the question raised about the typhoid. It has been validated in the Department of Pediatrics at JSS Medical College, Mysore, where they looked at the typhoid IgM, they looked at the blood culture, and they found, if I remember rightly, the typhoid actually outscored the blood culture. If you're going to do blood culture, it should be done properly. Minimum of 5 ml of blood should be taken. The blood to the volume of the broth should be 1:10. And the child should not have been on antibiotics. No, let us all be very frank and very truthful about this. How many of us will wait for a disease to evolve before we prescribe an antibiotic? If the parents are hyper and they come every day with the same complaint, on the third day, fourth day, we sometimes yield to the pressure and start writing an antibiotic. On day six, if we do a blood culture and the child has already been on cefixime or azithromycin or cefadroxil or comoxiclav, the blood culture yield will fall even further. So whether we like it or not, there are places where we can use a rapid diagnostic test, like the typhoid, like the CAR test for scrub typhus, but every test will have its own QC problems. The lab and the kit have to be validated. That is absolutely there. So without those understandings, I don't think it is correct to use a CAR test. We cannot say no to them. We have to learn to live with them and interpret them properly. All suggestions from the resource persons are acknowledged, and we will try to incorporate these changes in the module. Or when we are speaking, when the resource persons are taking this message across, they can always give their expert comments over and above what we have presented. Because this is a module where there is enough space for interaction. That is the whole point. Because this meeting was over 25 minutes ago. Yet on a Sunday evening, there are so many faces who are still happy to interact, share ideas, give suggestions. That itself shows what a wonderful professional organization we are, how much of dedication and how much of enthusiasm we have, and how much this is a felt need for the pediatrician. Otherwise, Sunday evening, we will appear in Okan that the Purme and the Kaker, which is Chance Gadeer.
Thank you.
FAIN criteria, I think I will request Janani ma'am. I am not used the FAIN criteria for leptospirosis. That suggestion was given by Janani ma'am. If she is online.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Yes, madam. Please.
Yeah, actually, modified FAIN criteria is a very useful tool. It was modified by one Dr. Shivakumar, who's a retired internal medicine physician from Stanley Medical College. He adapted it from the FAIN criteria, which was more applicable in the Western setup. He modified it to suit the Indian setup, and actually it uses clinical, laboratory, and epidemiological criteria. A score of more than 25 is suggestive of leptospirosis. Without your lab, a score of more than 20 is suggestive of leptospirosis. I have actually incorporated this criteria in the Piyush Gupta's textbook of postgraduate textbook and infectious diseases textbook in my chapter on leptospirosis. If you just Google, you can see the modified Fines criteria. It's very useful in the clinical setup for primary care physicians. It just scores fever, headache, conjunctival suffusion, myalgia. Score is given for each of these. And rainfall, the contact with contaminated water, I think that will be applicable for all our patients. So then you don't have to wait for the leptospirosis ELISA or your MAT. Even before that, you can make I follow it, and Dr. S. Balasubramaniam from our hospital, both of us follow that. And sir has actually done, guided a thesis on this by one of our postgraduates, Dr. Muthuraman, and who's practicing pediatrician in Trichy now. So it's a very useful criteria, Ashwat. You can use it in your clinical practice.
Thank you.
I think I've answered Vishwanathan. I've shared it separately with Vishwanathan.
Thank you, Dr. Janani, and thank you, Dr. Ashwat. And before conclude, for the vote of thanks, I just wanted to have an appeal for all the participants today. Please make your comments about this program in your respective district branches groups, IAP groups. And I just also wanted to know whether this timing is good for the further continuation of modules. The module is going to happen every month, first Sunday. If this is 6 to 7:30 is convenient, please make a point that this is a convenient time so that we can fix up for the subsequent modules the same time. That will be better. If there is anything regarding any questions to be answered, Rajendran, please go through the question box. Either otherwise, we can go for the vote of thanks. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. And if you are going for vote of thanks, I want to give a two announcement. And next week, we are having a Saturday teaching program, a PG teaching program from Institute of Child Health. And by Dr. Ravichandran, sir, PG is going to present case of anemia. And this month, and that's the fourth Saturday, last Sunday. That's every month. Last Sunday, we are having CME program. We are having infectious disease. Okay, Dr. Sudhakar and Dr. Narmada is they are going to arrange, there's a coordinators, they are going to arrange the CME on infectious disease. So now, any questions from anybody? So now we move on to vote of thanks. I request Dr. Gopal Subramaniam to deliver vote of thanks.
On behalf of IAP TNSC, I sincerely thank Dr. Ashwat, the flamboyant, as usual, Ashwat. My friend, it was a great presentation. It will be useful for all the practicing pediatricians out there. It was like a cover drive by David Gower. Thank you, Ashwat. And I thank all the zonal coordinators or moderators, Dr. Palanraman sir, Lakshmi madam, and Dr. Balashankar sir for their inputs. And I thank all the Central EB members and all the participants. I could find almost 100 participants out there in Sunday evening. It was a great opportunity to meet you all. And thank you once again. Thank you all.
Thank you, Thirumurugan, for doing a wonderful job of making this Zoom possible. Thank you, Thirumurugan.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Can we leave now?